Many thanks for joining us. I'm Sharon Momanyi. Our sign language interpreter is Meresha Awiti. Now we begin with the latest bombshell from the Director of Public Prosecutions in Kenya, Keriako Tobiko, who has declined a proposal to charge the Auditor General over corruption allegations hours after revealing that he was under intense pressure to prosecute Edward Ouko, the DPP. Tobiko released a file of recommendations in which he said there was no evidence to sustain such charges. Tobiko instead approved charges against Ouko's juniors at the Auditor General's office and directors of companies involved in the procurement of a controversial audit software. Timothy Otieno reports.
The directive dated the 3rd of February 2017 comes exactly 1 month after the Director of Public Prosecution, Keriako Tobiko, received files from the Ethics and Anti-Corruption Commission on the 3rd of January seeking to level charges against Edward Ouko in an abuse of office suit. The charges claim that Ouko irregularly procured an audit vault software at a cost of 100 million shillings against a market price of 18 million shillings, according to Tobiko, did not hold any water. In his analysis, Tobiko concludes that in all three charges leveled against Ouko, there was no sufficient evidence to back the claim that Ouko was at fault.
Ouko does not sit as a procurement officer. He does not even sit in the evaluation of procurement. Okay? Just like in these independent offices, the law is very clear on who is the procurement evaluation board, committees, and all that.
The DPP's directive coming after he blew the whistle on a plot to have him expedite the investigations against Ouko, a man some believe has been targeted by different quarters trying to frustrate the mandate of his office. In a statement to the Standard newspaper, Tobiko claimed that, quote, "I find it rather strange that an extreme wave of urgency has been imposed on this matter when the same was not there since 2014 when it was taken up by investigators." Ouko's file was opened after the National Treasury, through the Principal Secretary Kamau Thuge, raised several allegations against the Office of the Auditor General on the 8th of April 2014.
The investigation was being done in light of the investigations and the reports that the Auditor General had given for NYS and also for the Eurobond.
Ouko has been a man under fire since he revealed that huge amounts of money obtained through the Eurobond may have gone missing.
No, come on, let's call a spade this morning.
A situation that led even the head of state himself to openly criticize the Auditor General during a State House summit in October last year.
Surely. That the Kenyan government and the US government have colluded. Na huyu anasema anaenda, nataka kuenda ku interrogate Federal Reserve Bank of New York. Guy, anyway.
Tobiko's perceived loosened grip around the neck of the Auditor General, however, has not spared officers from that office, including the Deputy Auditor General in charge of corporate services, Stephen Kinuthia, Annette Mwangi, an IT manager at the Office of the Auditor General, as well as her colleague, Justice Ongera. Others found liable include Charles Gichobi, a sales executive at Oracle Kenya, Maina Shem Kamau, Ephantus Kairu, and Sylvester Kiplagat, all from OSI Kenya, the company that won the tender to supply the audit vault software. The Director of Public Prosecution also wants Mars Technology Associates, Finsoft TCS Limited, NK Holdings, Nanazi Investment, and the Kenya Milk Farmers Investment Limited investigated over money laundering in the scam. The Ethics and Anti-Corruption Commission will now begin official probe into the issue that has now seen Ouko dodge a bullet for a man heading an office established under the Constitution to eliminate corruption and wastage in the use of public resources.
Edward Ouko ndio kiongozi wa pekee mwenye amebaki mwenye anatufichuliwa vile pesa zetu zinaliwa.
The matter has taken the nation by storm, since the Auditor General's office has been one of the most respected and protected institutions in independent Kenya. Timothy Otieno, KTN News.
The Kenyan Opposition's National Super Alliance today unleashed their 9-point agenda, which includes, among other things, a free secondary education for all Kenyan children, recovery of public funds and property stolen by corrupt individuals, and raising revenue share for counties to 50% of the national revenue. And as KTN's Murimi Mwangi reports from Bomet, Bomet Governor Isaac Ruto moved closer to what might be an alliance with NASA.
The triumphant entry of the National Super Alliance Top Brigade into Bomet finally gave the strongest signals yet that the host governor, Isaac Ruto, may be headed into the opposition outfit as calls for residents to vote out the ruling Jubilee regime dominated the rally.
Unasikia police na county commissioner wanapanga watu wengine huko juu eti wakija hapa. Walete furugu ndio watupe tear gas ati wanataka kumaliza mkutano wetu.
NASA ni Kenya na Wakenya ni NASA. Jambo la tatu, munase kura ili tupate ushindi.
National Super Alliance ndio ambayo italeta ukombozi wa kweli Kenya hii. Wangapi wanasema hata mashinani tuingiane pamoja katika NASA? Ikisema mashinani, sema NASA. Mashinani!
The opposition leaders accused the Jubilee regime of reneging on their 2013 campaign pledges to Kenyans.
Uliahidiwa lami kilomita 10,000. Umeona hizo lami? Umeona? Umeona? Mliahidiwa laptop. Umeona laptop? Umeona laptop? Eh? Kwa hivyo ahadi ya Jubilee ni kama kunyamba kwa fundwa.
Leo hii watu huko Baringo, watu huko upande wa Elgeyo Marakwet wanakula fruits, wild fruits, na tuko na serikali.
Uhuru na Ruto, inji imewashinda. Wanatembea kusema tuna mipango, tumetenga, tutafanya, tuko na budget. Sijui tuko na nini, alafu sasa mnaona wanakimbia kila mahali kusindua miradi ya project.
CCM, NC.
Pledges to devolve more resources also dominated the rally. Israela revisited the Itare Dam controversy, which recently put him at loggerheads with the Jubilee regime.
Itare Dam in a theory, uchumi ya Narok. Uchumi ya Bomet, Kericho, Nyamira, Kisii, Migori, Homa Bay na Kisumu.
Isaac's chama cha Mashinani has for the past 4 years been the heartbeat of internal rebellion against the Jubilee regime in its Rift Valley stronghold. Also conspicuously present in Bomet was KANU Secretary General Nick Salat. The two, together with the 4 NASA principals, sought the blessings of some Kipsigis elder.
Isaac Ruto, na Nick Salat, na Ngong, na Gideon Moi, waungane na NASA. Unakubali waungane na NASA? Ungepe na kubali yonu kwa mkono.
Mimi niko hapa, I want to declare this meeting. This is a meeting we will declare, we will call it the gathering storm. For those of you who know history, the one Winston Churchill called it the gathering storm, and this is what this meeting is all about.
With a pledge to front a single presidential candidate dominating the talks on this podium, NASA will clearly be banking on Governor Isaac Ruto in their raid for the votes in the South Rift region. Murimi Mwangi, KTN News, Bomet County.
All right, and of course, during this rally in Bomet, the coalition of NASA just pointed out what their agenda will be, that they will be running on during their campaigns. And we just want to take a quick look at what that 9-point agenda is. We have the first one, which is uniting Kenyans. They say this is one of their biggest agendas that they have, that they will be selling to Kenyans, bringing together people from all the regions and all the ethnic groups in the country. They also say that they want to promote democracy, transparency, and inclusivity. They also want to provide security for all. And just to point out what they actually said, even during the event, that they are calling on the government to actually pull out the AMISOM, the our forces, the KDF forces that are in Somalia at the moment, saying that we need to reinforce security in the country. They also say that they want to stabilize county health services, saying that they want to provide universal health care to all Kenyans. Food security is also one of their agendas, and one particularly what they say is they want to see a reduction on prices of food commodities. If we can move to the other four of their 9 agendas that they put out today, they also say that they want to see a growth in Kenyan's economy, and saying that they want education to be accessible to all, saying particularly that they want to promote, actually to see that there is free education right from primary education to secondary school education. They say also that they will, go forth with the war on graft, saying that they will strive to recover funds that have been lost to corrupt individuals. And also their 9th point there, saying that they will seek to strengthen devolution, raising, county revenues from 50%, up to 50% rather, of the national revenues. Of course, most of these issues are what Kenyans are delving with at the moment, and it will be up to Kenyans to put them to task on the same. Let's move on now. And Deputy President William Ruto has thrown his weight behind the Kwale governor, beg your pardon, who is facing a defamation suit from Mombasa Governor Hassan Joho. Ruto and other Jubilee leaders promised Mvurya that they will stand by him until the matter is resolved. But as Francis Mtalaki reports from Kwale, Mvurya has sworn to stand by the very words that made Joho decide to sue him.
Day 2 of Deputy President William Ruto tour at the Coast Region saw the Jubilee Brigade led by National Assembly Majority Leader Aden Duale wade into the latest political rift between Mombasa Governor Ali Hassan Joho and his Kwale counterpart Salim Mvurya.
Mvurya bana, mambo ni sawa. Usibabaishwe na watu hawana capacity. Na lakini sikizi kuna evening classes. Ziko masomo ya jioni jioni. Hata magavana wanaanza kusoma. Lakini paka upite form 4.
Yeye alikuwa ameshikana na wazungu wote, sasa amepeleka Mvurya kotini. Mimi ndio fan wa makesi. Mimi ndio shabiki mkubwa wa makesi. Hiyo ulagai wako peleka kule umetoka. Gavana Mvurya na deputy gavana wako, endeleeni kutetea haki za wanakwale.
Tumemwambia asimame kidete, tuko nyuma yake kuhakikisha kwamba watu wa Kwale wanapata haki yao.
Mvurya says he is ready to face Mombasa governor in the corridors of justice over his controversial sentiments about Joho.
Sababu ya kutetea wakwale, hiyo haitaturudisha nyuma kuhakikisha tunaendelea kuhudumia wananchi wetu.
Unajua huyu Mvurya ni msomi, huyu amesoma. Lakini ule governor wa Mombasa, shida ni masomo. Shida ni masomo. Unajua kama baba yako haja kupeleka shule, tofauti ya huyo jamaa na Mvurya ni masomo. Huyu ana shahada, yule ana shahada mbili tatu, yule mara shahada haijulikani ni Kampala University, mara haijulikani form 4 alipata D minus. Kwanza kama angefanya mtihani wakati wa Matiangi. Kama angefanya mtihani wakati wa Matiangi, huyo jamaa hata angepata E, angepata chini ya E.
The Kwale governor earlier claimed that his differences with Mombasa governor began some 3 years ago when they fell out over mining of Nobia at Mrima Hill in Mauba. This rally was part of Jubilee's coast round of the voter registration drive. Francis Mtalaki, KT News.
And as the Jubilee team was attacking the opposition in Kwale, KANU chairman Gideon Moi told party members that he was disappointed by what he called Jubilee's lack of commitment towards development projects. Speaking after hosting over 500 KANU members from Mogotio sub-county, Gideon Moi termed most of the projects as empty rhetorics. Gideon further questioned Deputy President's interest in Baringo and West Pokot counties, where he has made visits more than 25 times. Gideon, who is also the KANU National Chairman, welcomed Dr. Noah Chepkech into KANU after he decamped Jubilee Party.
Leaders who don't look at individuals, but look at the commitments which they made to their people and the trust their people have on them. Come on.
We are entering a campaign period and many leaders will come here seeking for your votes. Just listen to them. However, there is one Jubilee leader who has been frequenting Baringo several times and lying to people about development projects. He has also been going to West Pokot, where he knows it is a KANU zone. He has actually gone there 35 times and 29 times here in Baringo. We wonder what his interest is here in Baringo. Assuming today I quit politics and decided to be a farmer, would he still be coming here in Baringo?
Wale waliondoka KANU na kuenda kuunda vyama singine. Na tafadhali, ukienda kuunda nyumba yako, usisarau papa na mama ambaye ulikusa. Hao namna gani? We are simply telling you as a people. This is the time democracy imekucha Kenya. Let us be in this party in black and white.
Kaunti ya Baringo, iko kati ya 47. Sina mna hiyo? Hakuna lami na chengwa hata moja. Na kaunti singine, sina chengwa lami. Na Bath Ruto nasema, ati iko hivi, iko hivi. So mambo ya Ruto jamani, waje tusidanganyane. Tunaweza kusema rasimali ya Baringo hii anapeleka kwake. Yeah. Kwa sababu kwake inachengwa lami 24 hours. Wapi ya Baringo?
As Kenya prepares to roll out a new curriculum that will focus on skills rather than performance in exams, it is a moment of reckoning for private school owners and parents. Most parents we spoke to admitted that they rush to private schools to ensure their children perform well in national exams. But with national exams now being pushed to the back burner, what will be the private school's advantage? This is the real issue behind the big headlines you have seen in Kenya in the last few days. And I spoke to all the stakeholders. Take a look.
Year in, year out, these have been the sights and sounds on television screens as national examinations results get announced. Schools topping the national charts in performance would look forward to such times when extra feathers would be added to their caps. Overall, private schools have been exhibiting better academic performance than the public schools.
We have reached a situation where examination drives curriculum.
With the imminent revised curriculum framework, which focuses on competence rather than summative evaluation, will private schools lose their edge?
As a parent, I feel the new system is good because there's no use now to take kids to private schools, and it's a general continuous assessment. And that way you can assess your kid. Private schools look for results, immediate results of kids who pass well.
What they would need to do is just to embrace the competence-based curriculum and go ahead and ensure that this is embedded as a culture within their schools. And once that happens, parents will still go there because you'll want to go to a school where you can see that your child, you know, is developing that culture of being able to do what they're required to do.
Let me disabuse the notion that private schools have excelled because of performance. Nothing can be further from the truth. Private schools have excelled because of a competency-based curriculum. When you look at the private schools, the ECD is the most popular. We have over 14,000 private ECD centers across the country, and they are very popular.
The Kenya Private Schools Association CEO Peter Ndoro, who was also a member of the new curriculum's steering committee, says private schools now have a chance to shine even brighter in the new system.
Many people have been looking at performance, but private schools have been doing much more than performance. Now the competency that the private schools have been impacting on the children will now be coming out on the fore, because everybody else has been focusing on one aspect, performance.
Opinion leaders in the sector point out that while the new curriculum poses a lot of merits, it is one that would be a costly one to implement. This would thus call for more investment into the sector, giving more leverage to private investors who either have easier access to funds or have profitable ventures to fund the process.
System as it is now is that two laboratories are too expensive for us to run. You may know of schools that children see equipment that they are supposed to use in the examination room because they don't have a functional chemistry laboratory or biology. Now, can you imagine we're going to add onto that load maybe a state-of-the-art gymnasium for those who want to pursue rugby and bodybuilding? You can imagine there are others who want to pursue football. So it means, literally, the equipment our national team uses to train for football needs to be in a secondary school that has chosen football as one of the offerings. That is where the challenge is, and it's going to cost us a little bit more during the initiation stages because money must go into it to make it work.
What could have been a problem probably to them? It's more of the physical infrastructure. But again, that I think is being handled at a different level because, again, with this framework approved, that is another area that I know the, you know, people in the ministry are working on. Because for us, there are certain areas where we can only make proposals.
The public schools are congested and we have very few teachers, so manpower is less. You find a school has a teacher handles around 120 pupils. So it's very difficult. If you want a child to be attended to very well, you have just still to go to private schools.
The basic education curriculum framework is set to be launched in a pilot program across 470 schools in Kenya, 10 in each county. During this phase, monitoring and revision of the curriculum will be taking place to ascertain whether it will be ready for official rollout in 2018.
We have been discussing with stakeholders, we have been discussing with the experts. I mean, if you wanted to hurry it, we would have done that engagement for 1 year, move on to pilot the following year, and move on to the third stage, which would be this year. But we said, no, this is something that we must get right.
The curriculum will be rolled out in a phase-in, phase-out basis, starting with the 2 years of pre-primary, grade one and grade two. Sharon Momanyi, KTN News.
Now, cancer has become a serious menace world over. It is estimated that it will directly affect 21 million people in the next 2 decades. As people world over mark the World Cancer Day, it was deliberately themed We Can, I Can, calling everyone into an active life, especially physically, as Dr. Mercy Korir reports.
Any other gym session will run something like this. However, this is no ordinary session, but one targeted at cancer survivors and their caregivers.
Ugonjwa wangu wa cancer nilipata 1998. Ilikuwa 97, siku ya nimehakikisha sana, lakini 98 ndio walikonifirm niko na breast cancer. Nikafanyiwa operation na nikaenda chemotherapy na radiotherapy. Na sasa naendelea na madawa ile tunameza kila siku inaitwa tamoxifen.
I was diagnosed with multiple myeloma in October 2015. Multiple myeloma is a cancer that affects the plasma of the blood.
I am a 12 years breast cancer warrior. I was diagnosed when I was 5 and a half months pregnant with this girl over here.
these cancer patients, they're very worked up, they get very stressed, and they're just to divert them, just to distract them from their daily therapies and their, you know, the treatments. I think this is basically a diversion.
Prostate cancer in men and breast cancer in women are the commonest cancers in Kenya. Growing evidence shows that physical activity helps cancer patients to manage the life-altering side effects of treatment, such as fatigue, depression, and heart damage. It also helps in reducing the risk of the disease worsening or recurring.
They feel like they've let loose, they forget that they're sick. You know, and then they sleep well.
Kwanza nilienda kufanyiwa counseling wakati saa hiyo tu, kwa maana hiyo ni jina cancer inamaanisha unakufa. Lakini venye nilienda counseling niliongeleshwa na nikaona cancer si kifo.
Nilikuwa miguu yangu inauma kidogo, unajua sasa shosho miguu haina nguvu. Ilikuwa ikiumauma kidogo, lakini wakati nilianza kufanya hizo exercise, yoga, breathing na mengi mengi tunafundishwa huko, ninaendelea vizuri sana.
By then I was wearing a brace. I couldn't do what I'm doing now.
So these therapies are to help them with their cancer journey. They are complementary, so it goes alongside the medical treatment and is just to make the prognosis better and give them a more holistic outlook in life.
This, in addition to being part of a support group, each of these cancer survivors undergo different types of complementary therapies, ranging from body massage to meditation and breath work. In this year's World Cancer Day, millions have been called to be active in every sense. By maintaining their individual health and well-being, each individual will contribute to the success in the fight against cancer.
What we do with Maisha is to tell people to live a healthy lifestyle and exercise.
As the Zumba class and the breathing exercises come to a close, it's clear that these exercises give these patients here a feel-good feeling, and they go home happy and rejuvenated with a willingness and a willpower to live and to live a positive life.
Dr. Mercy Korir, KTN News, Nairobi.
Our very own Dr. Mercy Korir, they are showing us how to beat cancer by being physically active. And also, you can also have fun while at it, as she demonstrates there in the Zumba class. Let's move on now. And as the world marks Cancer Day, 14-year-old Judy Kwamboka and her family are hopeful that she will get better. Judy, who suffers from cancer of the ENT, was able to receive urgent health care at the Texas Cancer Care Center when well wishers from Kisi and Nyamira and listeners of Radio Maisha raised more than 1 million shillings. The teenager from Nyamira began developing complications in October last year. By the time she was taken to a health facility in Kijabe, her cancer had advanced to stage 2 and tumor to stage 4. She now awaits her operation and is living proof of untold suffering of cancer, regardless of age or class, and the hope that comes from community support.
Hii ndio mara kwanza naniona. Na mimi tangu vile ilikuwa ilimwanzisha hii mtoto sinichui kama ni kansa, niliona kama ni homa. Niliwaombea mtoto hii yango mkimsaidia akifona, niliwaombea Mungu awasaidie. Asante.
Na utumaini mtoto wangu atapona kwa sababu alikuwa alimbaya, sasa huko anaendelea kupata madawa, anaendelea kupona.
We requested to tell the people from Radio Maisha. Immediately, I think he talked to Linda. Then when they heard that, they were touched, and then they told us to go and they covered the story.
And we hope that the doctors are really going to think about such patients who need help. Some cannot afford to be here, so we are very sure they're actually dying at home. And the government should really, really consider to have the doctors back.
What a great show of support. May she get well and get well soon. Now, Kenya's annual First Ladies Beyond Zero Marathon has been cancelled. The marathon was to be held on March 12th this year. A message from the First Lady posted in the official website of the President read in part, and I quote, "This year I was looking forward to running yet another marathon, a gratitude marathon. However, I have never been willing to politicize this agenda. As a consequence, I feel it necessary to cancel the First Lady's half marathon this year. I remain committed to and will not deviate from my ultimate goal, which is the betterment of maternal health care in this country and to build a Beyond Zero referral hospital," end of quote. Even though it is unclear what motivated the decision, many Kenyans believe the pressure from different circles not to hold the marathon in a prevailing and unresolved health crisis was the main cause. Let's move on now and imagine a scenario where high school students are monitored via CCTV cameras that are strategically placed in different corners of the school. With the monitors placed in the staff room and the principal's office, students of Karima Boys High School in Othaya have little room to bend the school rules. KTN's Carol Nderi tells us how and why.
Maintaining law and order in a secondary school requires all parties to pull together for a smooth flow of operations. But in Karima Boys High School in Nyeri County, something fresh appears to have happened. The CCTV cameras are strategically installed across the school compound, leave little room for the students to engage in any monkey business. The 27 cameras were switched on early January.
The students knowing that they are the CCTV cameras, it becomes a deterrent to indiscipline. So they know they are keenly watched, so they do not misbehave. And should they misbehave in any way, the evidence is available. So we can replay back 24 hours action and we can give hard evidence.
Karima has a special place in history. In its days as a primary school before it was elevated to a secondary school, retired President Mwai Kibaki went through his primary education here between 1941 and 1942. The school that also runs its own bakery is determined to ensure that it lives up to the task that it has been mandated to execute, that of transforming boys into responsible men.
We have the two monitors. One is placed here for the administration and one in the staff room. The one from the staff room, it's 24 hours. There are always two teachers on duty, so they'll watch whatever is happening in the school.
They have really changed the school because the students have now getting the self-drive.
The CCTV cameras have enhanced discipline in our school, and a lot of self-driven students is seen because teachers don't have to move around checking on what is going on.
The population of 820 students spread out in four streams. The audiovisual aid will go a long way in streamlining the school's activities. Not only are there CCTV cameras, but there are also fingerprint scanners. What do they do? If a student checks out of school or checks in, the scanners immediately notify the parent through an alert on the phone that the student has either left the school or has arrived in school. Because the scanners have the biodata of the students, the same applies when they need to withdraw pocket money from the school bazaar. The students at Karima are not allowed to keep huge amounts of pocket money. Once it is deposited or withdrawn from the bazaar, an alert is also sent out to the parent. Much as the cameras are there for surveillance, the privacy of the students is protected.
We have not installed cameras in any private places, the dorms, and other than public places, so it doesn't interfere with their privacy.
In 2016, KCPE, Karima Boys High School, posted a mean score of 7.27. Carol Nderi, KTN News, Othaya, Nyeri County.